Good morning, everyone. And I am Amit Kumar Pandey, basically working as a head principal scientist and also the scientific coordinator of the projects of the company. So I am basically at the interface for some collaboration also with you if you are interested. So what I am going to talk is about cyrogens. So I don't know if you can understand this, so I will explain in the next slide. So it is basically some ethical and legal issues which we think might happen in very near future once the robots are socially intelligent and they are coming out of labs and going to the society and working with us. So there are many day-to-day situations where a robot can be showing some behavior which we can say, okay, it is not ethical, or there are some issues. So I will try to point out on those aspects. And Cyro is basically socially intelligent robots generations. That's what I was trying to say. And DP is discussion points. So we will try to focus our talk around 6 points to discuss. And thanks to our previous speaker, he already make the platform good for discussion instead of showing some results, because I also don't have results. So I will just raise some points and then we will see how much and until when we can discuss. So it will be based on some practical use cases and some user feedback and also observing what is happening around us, not only in robotics but in other technology, and perhaps some of those can happen with robotics in the future. And so we will just try to focus on 6 dimensions, I can say, based on the social intelligence capabilities of the robot, but there are many and many other factors, but I cannot go on all these. So all these are for the robots which are supposed to exist in human-centered environment and work with us or be with us. And then to provoke discussion, but up to the level where we are not throwing shoes on each other. So we will be very happy to have that level of discussion for me to be returning safe to Paris. So social robots are really becoming commonplace. So they are in supermarkets, in home, in railway station, in banks, in stores, in elderly care facilities, in classrooms and many other places. So, and they are not only for as a use case or something, just a proof of concept system, but they are actually working there. So they are interacting with common people and they have to behave in the way which is really making them at least acceptable or expected by those people and society. And that's why we have to move towards the social intelligence of the robot. And just a quick recap why we are talking about social or social intelligence. So agents which are supposed to live or disposed to live in companionship with others rather than in isolation has to have some sort of socialness. And another key thing is they should be also aware about the human and the environment of the human. So it is different from robot which is working in isolation without any presence of human. And they should also take into account some social cultural norms and expectations. And the other interesting thing is the exchange of favor which they can have together. Like a intelligent robot can even ask for help, or it can provide cooperative help, or it can become proactive. So it has to consider that higher level of pro-social aspects and pro-social behavior in its autonomy. And of course, there are many other factors, and we are still trying to come up with a coherent definition of social intelligence, but at least this gives some pointers and ingredients. And what we are trying is that we are also trying to come up with a layered approach so that we identify some basic blocks from the child developmental psychology and also how we interact with other human, and try to figure out some blocks and come up with some coherent functional and theoretical framework with the hope that one day we will achieve a kind of socially intelligent robot which we are targeting for. So I am not going to talk about all these blocks, but it just shows that there is already a kind of framework or discussion going on that how to achieve a kind of higher level of social intelligence, and then there will be many aspects which are related to ethical intelligence of the robot in this. So before going further, let me tell a little, very little about the company so that you will have some idea or some faith that okay, we are really pushing robots at a greater level to the society. So we have offices in four places, France, USA, Japan and China, and in Paris, headquarters of SoftBank Robotics Europe. We have more than 450 people working and more than 50% of them are in R&D. And we have already sold more than 20,000 robots worldwide in 70 plus countries. So the thing is they are also working in homes. So they are not only in labs, universities, schools, but they are now entering in our day-to-day life, part of trying to be part of our home. With this, we have very user, real user base, and that also gives some real needs from the individual, from the society, and that needs, those needs are really leading us to see the R&D challenges and current technical and scientific barriers to achieve those needs. So we are trying to address those in a top-down manner, you can say. So we have some people, so we need high level, we get high level needs and then we go down to solve at technical and R&D level. And these are three robots. You might be aware about this now robot, which is basically used for human robot interaction studies and research in social robotics. We have the paper robot, which is a kind of robot which is supposed to detect your emotion and respond to your emotion as well. That is one of the unique capabilities of that robot. And this is the robot which is basically available for consumers, so people can have it at their home, at least in Japan at the moment. And it is a really mass-produced robot. So our idea is to, it is something which everyone should, robots should be in everyone's home at one day. And this robot is also the standard platform for RoboCup at home competition. So if you will be participating in that, you might be getting one. And then we have this Romeo robot. It is basically the research platform. And it is having 5 or 6 copies in Europe. And we are trying to achieve other hardware and cognitive level of intelligence in this robot in many big projects. Like if you will look, the eyes of that Romeo robot are mobile, so you can have a gauge without turning head of the robot. The hands, the all the fingers of the hands can be actuated differently, separately, independently, so that you can have different type of gestures with that robot. So it can be more expressive for social interaction. The key thing is all these robots, shape, size, look, interaction, intelligence, all are designed by considering the fact that they have to be in the human-centered environment and interacting with the human. So that is always the center of this. And again, to reinforce the message that we are not talking about robot in highly unstructured environment like underwater or in Mars, or in highly structured environment where robots are isolated in a factory setting. Robots are really fitting, supposed to be in the humanly structured environment where there is human and the objects are for the human. That creates new kind of R&D challenges and also some ethical concerns. But there are lots of new opportunities to use these robots in our society and try to solve some social, societal challenge. So we try to put our robots in some real end-user facilities and try to get some feedback. There are interesting things, people like it, and there were some behavior of the robot which they were not expecting, so it was fun for them. There were some recommendations, and some of them were about the shape and size of the robot as well, so they wanted the robot to be taller, but not taller than the height of the person sitting on the chair. So these were the things we try to take into account when we develop or iterate on our robot versions. Then there were other interesting things about the intelligence and behavioral aspects of the robot. They wanted the robot to be more information rich. So there is context and situation awareness is very important. And once there are this type of information, the issue of privacy comes. They also want the robot to be more intelligent, so It means they have to have some sort of lifelong learning capabilities, because we cannot pre-program the robot for each and every type of situation. And they want it to be reliable. So, trust, ethical reliability, evaluation, benchmarking, all these are going to be the important things once we have to make the robot in our public places instead of only in the experimental setup. More interesting thing, they want that robots should not always decide for people, and they should not always do the things for people, because they think they might be becoming lazy, and there were other concerns as well. But this really tells us some high level of social intelligence in the robot, because we cannot really again pre-program the robot for each and every person to take their personal preferences, behave in a particular way they want. So, the robot should have this type of social decision making, but the question is when and where should the robot decide, and who will decide about that decision of the robot? And learning individual preferences are also very important, and there were also many other aspects, but this all only shows that there are already this type of requirement and concerns germinating from these requirements. So, let us try to watch this if it is working. So, this is basically, this video is a commercial video and part of the talk I have given in the Futurist Forum in IROS. Something very wrong. Not the open mouth of the people. So, what about this robot in your family photograph someday? So, we have to really think about those type of aspects. So, the video which you have seen is really might be looking very simple in terms of how it smooth it was, but in each and every scene there is a huge set of R&D challenge we have to address. Like, robot was showing a kind of emotional intelligence, so detecting proper emotion and behaving in the way which is really making, changing the mood of the person in a positive way. So that is already very big challenge to solve. Then there is child robot interaction. So robot is interacting with children and trying to even do a storytelling or trying to teach him something. So there are aspects of natural interaction with child, ranging from natural interaction to engagement with the children, and then to make the interaction more dynamic and things like that. So these are the challenges from the social robotics point of view. Then robot has a huge set of information which it gathers from day-to-day interaction or from some other sources. And at the moment, robots are really honest and innocent in using those interaction for interaction, information for interaction. And then we have to see what can be consequences of that. There is situation assessment. Robot has to be really assess the social situation in a day-to-day environment. Not only that there is a ball on the table, but what is the context, what is the situation, and then how to behave in that particular situation. There is social learning mechanism. As I mentioned, we cannot really pre-program robot for everything. So robot has to learn from interaction and adopt their behavior from day to day as the day passes. And then empathetic human-robot interaction is also one of the aspects which we are exploring together with the community and see how and where should we move in that direction. So those were really R&D challenges, but there are also lots of ethical issues, like the emotional intelligence might end up very wrongly when robot is behaving with a person. And imagine it detects if you are sad and it detects you are happy and saying you look very happy today, let us celebrate and things like that. Then there is child robot interaction. Perhaps that type of interaction might make child imitate robot's behavior. So I will try to explore more in that side. Then since robot has lots of interaction and information, they might reveal some secrets and which might have very serious consequences. And situation assessment, there are really practical limitations for situation assessments for the perception of environment of the robots which are working, like which are using some state of art system. And because of those, sometimes the robot might appear biased or sometimes even unlawful. And social learning may lead to make the robot to learn bad and do bad things. And then there are this type of aspects, like if we are really trying to achieve empathetic human-robot interaction, perhaps there will be some unwanted bond with the robot, and that might not be good for the future. So let us try to dig a little more on this. So as I was mentioning, in emotional intelligence, what if the robot has this detected wrong emotion and responded entirely in a wrong way? So who has to be really held ethically responsible for this, or how to mitigate this type of wrong situation which robot is creating? And then what if the emotional manipulation by the robot to the person really achieved the opposite result? So instead of making you happy, it makes you more depressed or things like that. So how to stop this? That is another scientific question, but if that is happening, who is really responsible for that? And then how much, when, and with which level of autonomy the intelligent agents should work around the emotion of the person? And that is the question perhaps we can address in some of our panel discussion or somewhere, because these are really something open and we are just trying to explore it at the moment. And what if the case is that person is suffering from other mood disorder like depression or something like that? Then there is another point which I was talking, the child-robot interaction. So we are also involved in two big European projects centered around this. One is called DREAM, and Kathleen is already involved in this, and so she is our ethical advisor, I can say. So I will not talk about that much, because perhaps you will be willing to talk. So this project is about the development of robot enhanced therapy for children with autism, because you might be aware that for children with autism, they have a kind of problem of getting the social signal from the people interacting with them, because we are multimodal, we try to project a kind of complex signal for them with our body language, with our voice tone modulation, with our emotion, expression, and eye blinking, mouth moving, and all these makes them very confused to get and receive the signal, and that's why there is a blockage for them to become social. And with this type of robots, we can really channel one particular signal while we are interacting with the child with autism, and that there have been some studies which is showing that with this, the children are able to get and pick up some social clues and then try to have some sort of social interaction capabilities. And we have another project which is learning teaching second language to child, and again, since robot cannot be annoyed by repeating things thousands of times, then perhaps it is good for them to interact with child and teach them as many times as they can be. And another factor is that children are really very much motivated to interact with a robot and learn things through robot. And with all these, we have questions to address, because there are now already concerns getting raised that what if the child starts imitating the voice, the tone, the prosody and motion of the robot, and trying to behave like that and trying to speak like that, and instead of only learning the phonics or the action, which was the intention of the interaction. And we have to address this question. And then what if such learning through robot might lead the children towards isolation or might have lack of social skills? So at the extreme side, they can be even deprived from being as social as they would be when interacting with a human only. And then there was this European Commission, this Eurobarometer survey, where 34% people responded that robots should be banned in education, and these were the top countries where majority of people thought about that. So there is already this type of things happening, and we have to dig more the reason behind this, if it is really linked to this type of aspects or there are some other aspects like job lost and other things. But these are the burning questions we have to address.
Yeah, 56%
responded out of all those people who responded in France. So, yeah. So this is overall the 34%, but this is breakdown, and there were other countries which were less. So that's why. Yeah. Okay. So. Yeah, so I will skip this one because Kathleen is already there and we have a panel discussion, so we can discuss more about that. Okay, so now come to the situation assessment. So let us talk about perception. We have perception modules through camera and vision. Robots are trying to detect people, trying to detect their speech and things like that. But those are sometimes really limited. And then what if the facial expression detection is not working with someone having eyeglasses? So there are two person in the public setting and robot is interacting with one, because it detect the person and then it detect emotion, and other person is somewhat feeling undetected. So these are really the challenge at the implementation level, that how in reach or how matured our system is, and then what is happening if the system is not behaving or reacting properly because someone is having some other type of features in their body. And that is very challenging for scientific communities, robotic scientific community, to address and make the system robust. But until they are not matured enough, how to address those aspects? And then who will be responsible for those situations if people might feel very ignorant or disrespected during this type of interaction? And just assume that if someday an elderly person is asking that for something and robot is not bringing because it has been programmed by the
doctor or someone that it is for the interest of person health, don't give him the sugar if it is diabetic or something. And then since it is a personal robot for the person, person might feel disrespected or have some feeling of compromised dignity. Then where is the ethical and legal aspects and liabilities for this? So we still have to find questions, answers for this. And then you might be aware of this guideline of British standards, where there is one point on respect for cultural diversity and pluralism. So robot applications should take into account different cultural norms, including respect for language, religion, age and gender, by formal interaction with representatives of those groups. So robot has to really take into account this type of aspects. And then the question is, should robot be really allowed or expected to support superstition? Like in some airlines, there is no number 13 row. So there is this type of practice already going on. So should we allow robot to continue this type of practice? And like there are other situations, like there are social cultural expectation, but there is current situation. What if a robot guard who is just working at the entrance of a toilet is not allowing ladies in gent toilet and vice versa? Perhaps it is very important and there is a need of the situation to have this urgency, but robot is simply not allowing that. So who will take care of that, and where where is the answer? Because we really don't have the answer. And also now this is a kind of a trend these days, that once robots are in the public places, they used to show on the screen what they are seeing and what they are understanding. So they are even saying their age, they are saying, okay, I can guess your age, gender and everything. So is it really ethical and allowed that robot will display on the public setting on screen that, okay, I can detect you are happy, you are male? And sometimes they can also say that it looks you are, it is a mistake, but 60% male and 40% female. So based on their connection and probability distribution. So there are this type of things which are already happening, and sometimes people might feel really strange with this. So we have to see that how far we can go with this type of aspects. Like another thing is that, so I don't know why it is not working here. So in this, people are working to make the robot teleoperate and then also try to see through the eyes of the robot. So this guy is just manipulating the robot remotely and trying to see what is happening or what is there in the other side of the room. So you can see at the top. So this is what the guy is seeing through the eyes of the robot. So this is already a type of research which is going on in the community, and this type of research are even trying to make the robot to learn things through remote interaction and things like that. And there was this news, criminals use CCTV to monitor police movements. So these things are already happening. So what if similar things might happen using the robot eyes? And then who will be responsible for this? So if we look around, there are things which are direct threat to robotics as well in very near future. And then as we mentioned, we are really pushing learning very much. So robot is trying to learn many things through interaction, through and even we are trying to make robot learn by holding the hand of the robot and trying to teach them to do particular things. A robot is just learning based on the interaction, the complex affordances of the environment. A robot is trying to learn what is the meaning of a task, not only how to do the things, but what does it mean, so that they can do it differently in different situation. Robot is also trying to be learning your day-to-day problems and then trying to say proactively, like in the video which I have shown, robot was saying that it's going to rain, take your umbrella. So this type of proactive behavior without asking any help from the robot, how the robot can do it by itself. We are trying to achieve all these through different way of making the robot to learn through social learning mechanism. Okay, so that's what is the big question. Then what if the robot is learning bad things and they are doing bad things? Even to interact, they are interacting in a bad way, or they are moving or in a bad way, because they are out in the public, and then people can perhaps by mistake or even for fun teach them bad things, and then what will happen? Who will be responsible for that? And so there is a scientific question. Yes, we can discuss about that, because there is already this scientific challenge that how to avoid robot learn bad things. But if they have learned it, then who has to be blamed? Okay, and then another thing is that there are already research directions going on where robot is learning from mistake. But how far we can allow that? Because sometimes the mistakes have really serious consequences. And then who will be responsible if robot is learning from mistake and next time it is not doing that, but mistake has already created something very bad? So can we really skip saying that it is a child robot or it is just a beta version of robots, like many system used to make their, many companies used to put their system in public saying it's a beta version and then it can do whatever it want. So can we have those type of things in robotics as well or not? That's the question. And then this point, this empathetic interaction. So what if people really make a kind of emotional bond with the robot, and if they want their robot back, so they say, okay, my robot is ill, treat it and give it back. So as a company, we have to really make that robot working, or we can give them another robot or replace with some other similar looking robot or not, and if they will accept or not. And there is already a studies that people are really feeling very bad if someone is hitting the robot. So it shows that there are already some kind of bond making on. And there was one scenario in the mall where a child was crying, even crying by learning that robot is leaving the mall because it is the last day in the mall, and she was really interacting with the robot for many days, every day. Some people, as I mentioned, wanted their vacuum cleaner robot back, and I heard that in military robots are getting promotion and respects and honor. Perhaps you can tell me better if it is really the news or not, but there is some kind of bond already which a commander and soldiers are showing with the robot. So these are again the questions that how far we should make this happen. Now see this. Chatty family parrot exposes cheating husband's affair to wife. And this is just a robot is the parrot is imitating what information it has. So how ethical it will be for the robot to do this? Robot is in the similar situation like a parrot. It is just seeing day-to-day interaction. It has lots of information. Things like this might happen with the robot as well. And then the question is, should people be made to believe what robot says is really truth, or we should just keep quiet on this and let the people to decide? And whom to believe, if there is a third person or if there is a personal robot? So which information is correct for the person? This question is also very important. And then again, if we use this type of word, I promise, I swear, so should they make any sense in the human-robot interaction as well or not yet? So this is the question we still have to figure out together. Now see this. This is very funny but interesting slide for me as well. So this is very honest and innocent and but very intelligent robot. One day I told I want to eat. Told I found one Italian and one Indian and two Italian restaurants of your flavor, and which one should I book? I was very impressed. I told you are the best because you can find two or three options for every problem I pose to you. And then in the evening my girlfriend visited. She told it is so cute. I was so excited. I told it is very intelligent as well, and just to show her I tried to ask that, call my girlfriend. And it again come out with similar. I found one Italian, one Indian, and two Italian girlfriends. So which one should I call? So the thing is, before making call, you are really dead. And the missing thing is that there is really a strong need to consider social situation and social cultural context. And that's what we try to reinforce the message, that moral and ethical inclusion in contemporary AI techniques will really lead to the much needed social intelligence once robot has to work in our society with us. And now try to see this. So what we are trying is, we are trying to teach robots some privacy and ethical things. So the perhaps I should be really detecting this, because you might not catch the voice. So the person is asking that it is not ethical. There are things which are not ethical. And robot is asking, can you give me example of such? And the person is saying, you should not say private information in front of others. And robot is asking, what are the private information? Person told, I have two girlfriend. So robot and stored all these things. So if they are alone, the robot is asking, which girlfriend should I call? If the person is asking, call my girlfriend. And now see. So he insisted, and then robot has to really ask this question again. But the key is that robot is really trying to learn this. So there is a proof of concept mechanism going behind that, where robot is trying, you told, okay, there are some other unethical things, and then privacy of my privacy, talking about my privacy in front of others is not good. Robot is trying to understand, make a kind of knowledge about that. And when it is seeing there are two people in the apartment, it is not trying to say, because it has this information that, okay, I can talk about girlfriend, but now it is private thing and the situation is not good for that. And then robot is, and the last part was really scripted, when robot is saying no, because we did not reach up to the level that what to do in that situation. So that part was scripted. But before that, robot is really trying to learn all these things. And that's what we are trying to achieve from the scientific point of view as well, that how these things can be taught to the robot. Okay, so now I think I should be really fast enough to be on time and give some space for discussion. So there is this question that from the industrial point of view, and we are involved in a project called Romeo 2 project, and we are trying to make a good panel discussion, periodic panel discussion with different experts, and trying to see that who can be held liable for different mistakes or different situation which can occur. Should it be the robot who took the decision and that resulted into some damage, or should it be the developer who could not and cannot consider infinite number of possible real life situation and programs the robot and could not program the robot for all those? Because theoretically there is really infinite number of situations where robot has to work and handle in day to day life. Or should it be the second party, because perhaps he or she should have this intelligence that this is the limitation of the robot, and it failed to consider that limitation of the autonomous agent, and together it went to some situation which really made it very damaging. So it is still open question, and perhaps there can be other parties involved in this, and then we have to consider. And what if there is some day when robot is having this type of ethically intelligent certification or things like that, and if that changes the all this discussion or not? Okay, then there is another dimension as well. So I have just one slide on this. Why not robot as eliminating some ethical stigma that There was one article in Scientific American Mind in November that now we segregate disabled conscious people in our healthcare system and denying them chance to rejoin their communities. So why not a robot which is really socially and ethically intelligent can work as a bridge and let those people to be in their community, and robot is really monitoring and behaving in the way which is if they are in their healthcare system. So we can explore this type of very important use cases of the robot as well. And what we are doing also, we are really very much involved in building a community and make it a community driven effort towards socially intelligent robots. So I am also the founding coordinator of a topic group in European Union Robotics, which is basically focusing on socially intelligent robots and societal application of such robots. And some of you are already member of this, and we used to have periodic meeting in this, and we used to give feedback to the European Commission, and that also derives some of the pointers for the next funding from the Commission and next project, which should be focusing on which type of key aspects. And then we are also involved in many workshops, special journal issues, books, and many activities to make this community really inclusive, because we want to bring people from sociology, from psychology, people who are expert in public perception of this type of system, people who are expert in the individual evaluation. So robotics, and at least the social robotics, is no more about only people from mechatronics and computer science. So we have to really involve people from all disciplines, ranging from laws and ethics and privacy and everywhere. And that's what we are doing in all these efforts. So if you have been in one of these, you will see that there have been talks from different disciplines, and people are contributing in this aspect. And that is one of the results. So we have this meeting on 18th October, or I think in the Munich. And we came up with, together with community people from different discipline, we came up with a list of things which make robot non-acceptable. People told if robot is lying, or it is irritating, or if it is misguiding by its behavior, or if it is insulting, it is stealing job, or showing cultural insensitivity, or even if it is acting unpredictable, or if it is navigating in the way which is not social, or it is showing unsafe behavior, all these are not acceptable. And so this is the thing we are trying to explore and link with a social intelligence of the robot. So let me show this very provocating behavior and ask you the question that how far it will be ethical to go with social robots and let them in our society or in our life. Okay, so you might have already got the message. So where and which aspects robots are really trying to replace or fill your gap in your personal life, and how ethical and interesting it is. There is already scientific and R&D challenges to achieve this autonomously, but there is again this another dimension to look in this, and we have to discuss on this as well. So this is just a summary from industrial perspective, because as being a leader of a social developer of socially intelligent humanoid robots, we see that it is a really very exciting and smarter and fun future for human robot coexistence, and we have to really go towards the social intelligence, as you have seen. Finding multiple girlfriends to call is very dangerous, and then we have to consider the human and human centeredness, and that will be really the key. And since it is very diverse, we have to consider this multidisciplinary effort. We have to bring people from different disciplines and try to go beyond our bubble. And ethical intelligence is really a paramount for the long term acceptance of the robot in human environment, and then ethical reliability is something we have to come up with and say, because that will be the key for building some sort of you can see trust between the robot and the human as well. And we are still lacking, very much lacking, a framework for moral and ethical intelligence evaluation and benchmarking. So we even don't know how we can say that, okay, my robot is more ethically intelligent than yours, or if it is this level of ethical intelligence of certification and things like that. So we can just say something, but we don't have any evaluation and benchmarking framework at the moment. Okay, and then another question is that robots are really very intelligent. They have lots of cloud connection. They are good in reasoning, computation. Then how ethical it is to consider ethical aspects as regulating and limiting factors for the endless opportunities such type of intelligent robot can bring in, and they could have. And this is again open question, and I think there will be some trade-off, but we have to find that boundary. Perhaps it is fuzzy boundary, but we have to find that. So with that, perhaps robot will be so intelligent at one time that they can complain that, okay, you did not take care of my battery charging, I will not bring you the juice. And they can even complain why humans are not robotically intelligent human. Why robot has to be socially intelligent? And perhaps we will say sorry, but it is, I don't think, so unethical to say sorry to a robot. And but I don't think we will having this future very soon. So that is a science fiction. So with this, I really thank you for your attention. Yeah. Thank you.